work out.
Okay, so thank you all for coming, to those in the room and to those elsewhere. Really appreciate it. To What's in a Name or a Number, Attorney Advertising and Ratings, our presentation for tonight. I will go light on my own introduction because I'm not actually doing the introductions, but I'm here from Dechert and also from Hofstra and also from the New York State Bar Association Committee on Attorney Professionalism, which are the three sponsors of this event. I'd like to welcome you all and thank you all for coming. I hope you enjoy. As one housekeeping matter, I am going to read an introductory message, which is a CLE-oriented message, which is, for those attending this webinar, the webinar has been approved for CLE credit in New Jersey and New York. If you would like to receive CLE credit, please print the affirmation form sent to you so that you can note the code when it is read later in the program. Forms should be returned to the email address indicated at the bottom of the form. For attending the live program, for those attending the live program, you must complete the course evaluation form in your seminar book. So with that, I'm going to also read one more thing from the chair of our committee, Lillian Moy, and she asked me to read the following note. On behalf of the New York State Bar Association's Committee on Attorney Professionalism, I welcome you to this training. I am so proud that our committee's report, which you'll hear about later, led to tonight's presentation. I want to thank our host and co-sponsor, Dechert, and our other co-sponsor, Hofstra Law School. Special thanks to committee members Andrew Oranger, Robert Kanowitz, and Vivian Wesson, without whom tonight would not be possible. And with that, Vivian, I'm going to hand it to you to start us off.
Excellent. Again, thank you all for joining us here tonight for an evening of ethics. It's always an exciting topic to have a discussion on the standards of appropriate conduct within the legal profession. But this makes it a little more exciting because we're talking about conduct as impacted by our increasingly electronic age. My name is Vivian Wesson, and I serve as the chair of the Technology Subcommittee of the Committee on Attorney Professionalism. Really big mouthful. But my day job is actually spent as the Senior Assistant General Counsel for Marsh & McLennan Companies, where I work primarily with our reinsurance subsidiary, Guy Carpenter. Joining me today on this distinguished panel are Robert Kanowitz, who has been a tax lawyer, investment banker, as well as consultant for over 35 years. Robert also co-authored the committee's report on attorney ratings, about which we'll speak later in the program. Drew, who just previously introduced himself, is a partner here at Dechert, but he's also the co-chair of their employee benefits and executive compensation group, and he's the co-author of the attorney ratings report. And he's also an adjunct professor at Hofstra Law. And immediately here to my left is Professor Ellen Yaroshevsky. She is the Howard Lichtenstein Distinguished Professor of Legal Ethics and the director of the Monroe Friedman Institute for the Study of Legal Ethics at Hofstra Law. She also co-chairs, because you're ready for ethics tonight, the Ethics, Gideon, and Professionalism Committee of the American Bar Association's Criminal Justice Section, as well as the Ethics Committee of the National Association of Criminal Defense Lawyers. So we are going to begin our program by going over an overview of ethical rules and opinions. We'll follow that by a discussion of how that has impacted social media and how it affects our ethical obligations in attorney advertising. We'll then explore the Bar Association report on attorney rankings, and if time allows, we'll have a discussion on touching on attorney referrals. I now turn the program over to Ellen.
Thank you so much, Vivian, and thank you both for organizing this program. My job in 15 minutes is to give you an overview of all of the rules, the ethics opinions, and the law regarding advertising, social media, and ratings. Okay, and then we're going to talk about a terrific report that Andrew and Robert actually co-authored on lawyer ratings. I will tell you that when I teach this subject to students, I don't teach this as this is like real ethics, right? Real ethics is conflict, confidentiality, and then we have a series of rules that I refer to as the etiquette of the profession. And the reason I say that is when we have many, many rules regarding advertising, regarding payments for referrals, but what it's really about is how do we feel about having these exist within our profession. I've served on a lot of bar committees where we consider these various rules, and we're always balancing the notion of, yes, we're a business. At the same time, we are a profession. And how do we achieve that balance? That's what these rules are about. What I'm going to do is, in this 15 minutes, start with a historical overview. And it's not only because I'm a law professor, it really is because the history, I think, gives you a really good sense of where we are now in trying to figure out how we regulate the current issues, right? We've had these rules long before we had technology. We had these rules long before we'd ask questions like, if I put your law firm's name on a coffee cup and gave it out to everyone as a free coffee, is that advertising that's permissible? Is that advertising at all? Believe it or not, I spend a good deal of my life thinking about these questions, which is how many angels can dance on the head of a pin. So I'm not going to subject you to each and every one of those questions, but I just throw that out there in terms of the coffee cup, which is not an ad, it's branding, by the way, instead, just to get us started. So here's where we are. We've had advertising as a culture for a long period of time, but within the law, we really haven't had legal advertising until 1977, when lovely, very tasteful lawyers in Arizona decided they were going to put up an ad in a newspaper that just had their name and the kinds of work they did. And, of course, the bar said to them, no, you can't do that. That's unethical. Case went to the Supreme Court, in the case you may remember, known as Bates versus Arizona, and the Supreme Court for the first time talked about lawyers' commercial free speech rights. That was the first case, all right? It's 1977. It's not that long ago for many people in this room. For others of you, it may seem like ancient history, right? But it's less than 40 years ago that we first said lawyers can actually engage in advertising. Before then, it really was considered not good etiquette for the profession, okay? Subsequent to that, in the next 10 years or so, the Supreme Court then got involved in regulating not only advertising but solicitation. What's the difference? Advertising is generic. You hold yourself out to offer services to the public. Solicitation is when you offer services to a particular group. And so the cases that the Supreme Court considered over the next years were, could you engage in in-person solicitation, often known as ambulance chasing? And that sort of answers the question, doesn't it? Because the answer is absolutely not. And the reason is we don't want lawyers to engage in overbearing a client's will. And that the notion is that if you in person go talk to someone, they can't resist in some fashion or other. People take umbrage at that notion, but in any event, that's the state of the law. We want to protect clients, and we want to protect them from lawyers. On the one hand, we want to ensure that they receive the information they need. On the other hand, we don't want lawyers to step over that proverbial line. So in-person solicitation was banned. It's banned by statute in New York. It's banned by statute in other jurisdictions as well. So you could be criminally prosecuted as well as subject to discipline. So then came the question of, okay, you can't solicit in person, but how about by sending mailing to certain people? If there's an airline crash, can you get the names of everyone who's involved in that crash, somehow the families, and send the families targeted letters? That case went to the Supreme Court as well. Once again, they balanced lawyers' First Amendment rights, First Amendment commercial free speech rights, right, against this notion of what we're trying to protect the public. And we came up with the three-part test, the central Hudson test, for those of you who care about these things or know, which basically says it is a balancing test. Yes, lawyers can engage in careful targeting. They're permitted to do so. And each time there's a regulation that's going to affect the lawyer's First Amendment rights, either to advertise or solicit, we're going to look at the regulation. We're going to see whether or not it has narrowly tailored that regulation to deal with some specific harm that they're concerned about, and then whether the regulation actually achieves that goal. The best example of that is the most recent case, which is a case called Florida Went For It. Somehow most of the cases in advertising come out of Florida and New Jersey. Those are the cases. Florida, if you ever go to Florida, there are more lawyer ads per square mile than anywhere else in the country, okay? They are heavily regulated, okay? Florida Went For It, the bar passed a law that said you can't advertise within, you can't target people within 30 days of an incident, of an airline crash. You're not permitted to do that. That case also went to the Supreme Court. It's an interesting opinion by Justice O'Connor where you can see she's really uncomfortable with the idea of lawyer advertising in general. It's like bad etiquette. And they ultimately said, yes, Florida, that's a narrowly tailored regulation to protect people. You can have a regulation like that. Subsequently, New York adopted a similar kind of regulation for certain kinds of injuries, for personal injury and for wrongful death. So what we have is a scenario that leads to ethics rules that says, on the one hand, lawyers have First Amendment rights. On the other hand, we're trying to protect the public from overbearing lawyers. And what we end up with is a series of lengthy advertising rules throughout the country, particularly in New York, that fundamentally say lawyers can advertise so long as it's truthful, not deceptive, and not misleading. And of course, we have numbers of opinions, as you might imagine, because we're lawyers, as to what those terms actually mean. In the last 2 years, partly as a result of social media, there are 28 separate ethics opinions that have been written in the field of advertising and social media. It's really unheard of. It's a huge number of ethics opinions. These are opinions of the State Bar, City Bar, Local Bar, the Nassau Bar, dealing with various aspects of lawyer advertising, lawyer social media, lawyer solicitation. A lot of this started pre-technology. So we had ethics rules, and I'll just tell you the numbers. I wasn't going to put them on any slide because the advertising rule is so long, it would take at least 4 slides. The advertising rule in New York is very extensive. It tells you what you must put in any ad, and it has things like you must put in your name, your address, a way to contact you. You have to keep a copy of your ad. They're very extensive and very specific regulations. If you engage in advertising, it is imperative that you look at that rule because you have to dot every I and cross every T in order to advertise properly. There was a challenge to New York's rule in a case called Alexander v. Cahill. Why? New York's rule said, before 2007, you couldn't have actors portraying lawyers. You couldn't have judges portraying lawyers. You couldn't have monikers. You couldn't have terms like heavy hitters. There were lawyers upstate that used terms like heavy hitters in their ads. And so that case was challenged as well on constitutional grounds. It went to the Second Circuit. The Second Circuit overturned a number of those regulations, including the fact that lawyers couldn't use actors and you couldn't portray a judge in an ad. What it does require, though, and this is consistent with this notion that you have to have truthful, not misleading, not deceptive advertising, there must be a disclaimer. If there's an actor portraying somebody, it must say there's an actor portraying you. If there is a judge being portrayed, it must say that as well. So we have a regime, particularly in New York, truthful, not non-deceptive, non-misleading, and appropriate disclaimer. As a result of Alexander v. Cahill, we went back to the drawing board in New York. We modified our ethics rule, Rule 7.1, and fundamentally now the regime is not false, deceptive, or misleading. You can't promise results. You can't really lead people to believe, and you are now going to win the lottery, right? You're going to win $100,000 if you come to our office for this case. You can't engage in any kind of comparative statements, and you're going to hear more about that when we get to the ratings report. But in your ads, you can't say, I'm the best lawyer. You can't have a moniker, www, best lawyer.
Looks true.
Even if it's true, even if you think it's true, you can't do something like that. And you can't have statements about the quality. You can't say, I'm the best lawyer. That those are the kinds of things that we are prohibiting. This was all, as I said, pre-internet. And then along came the internet. And along came chat rooms. And then there are a whole host of questions we're going to talk about regarding chat rooms. Lawyers, they don't use chat rooms as frequently now as we did. I don't know, it seems like ancient history, but it was like 10 years.
Dinosaurs walked here.
Right. But there were lawyers would be in a chat room with somebody trying to get a date or whatever, and then they'd say, oh, I'm a lawyer. And someone would say, oh, I have a real estate problem. Can you help me? And, of course, we had ethics questions as to whether or not, if someone says that, can you give them legal advice? Is it legal advice? What can you say? What can't you say? Really, we spend our time in various ethics committees considering these questions ad nauseum, okay? Can you solicit in a chat room? Are you permitted to do that, right? So there's a whole host of questions that came along with respect to that. Then, of course, you have LinkedIn. right? What do you have to say? Is that an ad? If you put your LinkedIn profile up there, are you advertising? Are you soliciting? We're going to talk about some of those issues tonight. What are the criteria regarding that? Then, of course, there are questions, and there are answers to some extent in our ethics rules about if you have disclaimers in your ad, how big print do you have to have? There was a case where there was 6 inches of print. It was a 6-inch print, and the court said, no, it's not big enough. You need larger print so that the public could actually understand that this is really a disclaimer. I say that a bit tongue-in-cheek because it gives you a sense of the extent to which each of these issues is regulated. One of my colleagues has just written an article saying, let's stop regulating lawyer advertising because it's really gotten out of hand. Let's just leave it to litigation. If someone wants to sue lawyers, that's fine, but it's time that we stop this regime of constant ethics opinions and constantly lawyers not understanding what it is that they're permitted to do. A few more issues. We had a question as to whether interactive, like if you're on Twitter, you're on Twitter with somebody else. One, is that considered an ad? And if it is, it's a real problem because you have 140 characters, and the advertising rule requires that you put on a whole host of information, your name, your address, how to get hold of you, which would take up your 140 characters. So that remains one of those unanswered questions out there about what do we do about tweets? Can tweets be considered ads? There's LinkedIn, as I said, there's Reddit, which shows that these rules that we have thus far don't always work, okay? When we recently talked about the question of prohibiting in-person solicitation, which is clear has been prohibited for a long period of time, and we also prohibit telephonic communication, that's also been prohibited extensively since the late 70s, what about on various forms of social media? Is that considered telephonic or in-person? So what we did was we added to the ethics definitions the term real-time communication. So you can't engage in telephonic, in-person, or real-time communication. It's all considered the equivalent of in-person. The notion here being we're still trying to protect the public, if you will, from some form of lawyer overbearing, lawyers promising false results, lawyers getting clients in situations of establishing a lawyer-client relationship when a client may not want it. The most recent opinion has to do with can you ask a client or tell a client, I'll give you $50 back if you rate me on one of your sites, right? This is always a very good exam question, right? You think, can you do that? Are you permitted to do that? Under what circumstances can you do that? And the bar recently said, this is a New York bar, yes, you may do it so long as you may give them the $50 back so long as they do the rating, but not so long as they promise a certain kind of rating. They can't say, will you please rate me, like people do with Yelp, right? If you ever go into a restaurant or a hotel, they say, can you please go online and give us a high rating, right? You can't, as a lawyer, do that, but you can promise someone $50 or whatever amount of money you would like so that they rate you properly. So the point being here, we have a lot of regulation. As I said, one of my colleagues is suggesting we no longer regulate, but we're not going to be in that regime anytime soon, particularly if you're in New York, you're in New Jersey, or if you're in Florida, three states that regulate lawyers very highly and extensively. One has to be really careful moving forward. So, 15 minutes.
Thank you so much, Professor, for that very thorough overview. Now that we have a great foundation, let's delve into the discussion how these various rules actually impact attorneys in this increasingly electronic age. We'll explore a few case studies on legal advice through social media, your various communications with clients, especially the instant ones, general rules on attorney advertising, and how ratings can be used in such advertising. So, you don't like me, huh? You're not going to advance? Look at you, fucking little...
Okay.
And there we go. So,
instant communication.
Case study number one, Google Talk or chat or now Hangouts is out and, you know, there's Snapchat. So just imagine it's just some instant communication sequence. So during a conversation you have with your neighbor in a chat room, can you respond to her request that you represent her in an employment discrimination case against her employer? Is the answer A, yes, since the neighbor initiated the request via chat, you can reply there? Or is it no, she must make her request again through non-public means? Or is it yes, only if she's already agreed to your retainer or you have an existing attorney-client relationship? Or is it yes, but any reply to her request must be sent through non-public means? Any volunteers? Not doing the Socratic method here, because we all really love that from law school. Anyone think the answer should be A? You can reply there because that's where she initiates the conversation. What did the ethics rule say there?
Well, let me try to take a guess here, which may well be wrong, which is if one imagines that we're trying to get to the point where we believe that this sort of modern day communication is just a substitute for speech, then I would have thought that A is right because you know, the request came in and then the answer comes back. If, however, one believes that we haven't yet gotten to the point where this kind of modern communication is a substitute for speech, then that would seem to be incorrect. So I'm going to guess that we've gotten to that point, but I have no idea if I'm correct.
Anyone else think A is the right answer?
I think it could possibly be the right answer because it's not actually advertising. I think that in terms of communication, most people communicate via text message versus the phone. Like, people don't even care about how many minutes come up the phone plan anymore.
And neither does Verizon. It's unlimited. Include it with your plan. I'm sorry, one of the gentlemen was responding that probably A would be the correct answer. And you'll be happy to know that the Bar Association, in one of their recent opinions, 1049, actually opined that a potential client can post a message on a website or a chat room such as this, asking the lawyer to contact them about something. This is, in this case, a neighbor. The lawyer can respond via the chat, yes, I can continue the representation. It's not considered a solicitation. But now here's the catch. Well, it might not be a solicitation because you were directly approached by your neighbor. If you then go on to talk about what you could possibly offer the neighbor, it's now advertising. So you now have to make sure you're following the advertising rule. The best rule of thumb, if you're in a situation in such as this case number one, is to make a reply via outside of a chat room type of arena. Send the person an email, send it the 160-character text message suggesting that they have a separate conversation with you or a separate meeting. Those are the types of things that would end up covering you in the event that anything that you sort of disclosing in this chat room may not necessarily be privileged.
The other thing to say is that it's really important who initiates this chat room. If the lawyer initiated it, there's a much greater risk that you're going to be found to have violated a rule. But the client, here we say the client initiated, at least we know that in the answer. And so it would be wise there, and I always think of this from a risk management perspective for lawyers, which is what's going to get you in trouble later on, right? How do you avoid trouble? And the best way to do so is actually to have the client, to set up an appointment where you sit down and talk to the client later. You can respond in kind via chat room if the client's initiated it, but then have the client come in and meet you.
And just so that I understand, the hypothetical here is that there's nobody else in this chat. Is that correct or is that incorrect?
Something, the one-on-one chat.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Right.
I mean, you're certainly not going to have the client give up confidential information in a chat with other people. I assume that we all agree with that. Okay.
I mean, why would that be any different than a telephone call? Your neighbor called you up on the telephone and said, can you represent me? And you say,
it's going to
offer you.
It's not.
Okay.
It's not. But now in the arena of social media, it's the instant creation of an attorney-client relationship that's being given over this instant 160 characters or less type of communication with your client. The caution is Google Talk and a lot of these other sort of instant communications, they're not savable. They're not records that you can actually keep.
Neither a telephone call.
Well, a telephone call, you can keep a log of the telephone call. The idea of any of these types of communications is once it goes away, you don't necessarily have a record of what it is that you discussed. you can always reduce into writing, I guess, a phone call or a Google chat. It's a little a different scenario.
This is exactly the reason why we amended the in-person telephonic. We amended it to add real-time communication for this precise kind of scenario. You're exactly right. It's just like a telephone call.
But I was asking something else. And that was, if my neighbor calls me up on the phone and says, can you represent me? I can say yes. And if he said, well, describe some of the strategies we might employ in this case, I mean, I don't think anybody feels that there's any restriction whatsoever on that. No one says, no, we have to meet in person, or we have to set up an appointment, or I have to send you a letter. And my question is why you can't do the same thing with Google Chat.
You can. Yeah. You can do exactly the same thing. What I'm talking about is if you want to minimize your risk, about having a lawsuit lit later on, much better to have an in-person communication with the client, any client.
Question from the audience.
I guess my question would be, like, in a different, I guess, like, if you're having a conversation on a Google chat, could that possibly be breaking privilege if they're your client, depending on the specifics of the case, based on, very intrusive terms of service if, agreements between you and Google where they say that they can access everything that you type in.
Okay, so the question from the audience is there an issue with respect to attorney-client privilege where you're using a computer mechanism like this, but the sponsor of the of the site, if you will, has the right to dive in and see things that are being said? So now does Google's right, in this hypothetical, to see what's being said in the chat somehow compromise the privilege?
And the answer to that is actually in an ethics opinion that says lawyers have the obligation to keep up with technology. That's number one. Number two, that when it comes to very sensitive conversations between lawyer and client, you must be aware of the method of communication you're using, and that if it's something like Google Chat, it would be important not to convey sensitive information over that mechanism and have the client either talk to you by telephone, some secure telephone line, and or see them in person.
Yeah, and that's to your point, Robert. Anything here, since we're talking electronic, internet-based, hackable. You potentially destroying privilege. You may say, I'm going to represent you by Google Talk, but I don't think you would have the additional conversations as you would telephonically with them via the Google chat.
But that's a different
question. That's a different question.
That's a different question. And you know, telephone communications if someone really wants to.
A wireless. Got that.
But I think that's different because there may or may not be an expectation of privacy in a telephone conversation, but in Google chat, as the question from the audience sort of points out, if you know the user's agreement, you know that somebody can dive in and see what's being said. So I guess that's
correct.
A potential nuance, right?
Correct.
But you also know that in respect of anything, the NSA can get an order.
Well, I was going to say in the world of Edward Snowden, right, everything that you do or say potentially is subject to being overheard. But that doesn't say that there's not a legal right, a legal right to protect that information. So it's different that if you sign a Google, if you know on Google Chat that they have the permission.
Well, what just came out, I think, with Yahoo is that Yahoo was requested by one of the agencies and without notifying anybody that they were doing it, recorded everything.
Correct.
Right.
So a few tidbits of general advice about giving legal advice through social media. General answers and advice are permissible under our ethical rules, but specific legal advice is prohibited. If you intend to actually develop an attorney-client relationship, best to do it offline, not in a Google chat room or Facebook. So real-time or interactive computer, what they call computer access communications, are the equivalent of the sort of telephonic means that Ellen was just referring to. And those are regulated, those types of social media, the same as any other communication you might have with your client.
I'm going to say it's like at home. People come on and ask this question, I'm sure you guys are aware of that, and they give a fact pattern. Now, if you're you have some specialization in the field and you have experience in it, what constitutes specific legal advice? Now, if they give you a fact pattern and you give your your opinion on whether they have a claim.
That's legal advice.
So let me just repeat the question, okay, which is that what if you have a situation, as you might have in AVO, according to the question that's being posed, where a specific fact pattern comes across, and then what then is the status of the response? Is that legal advice, and what are the nuances there?
And so we make a distinction between legal information and legal advice. We have spent years trying to come up with an adequate definition. The closest one gets, and it's not satisfying, is if you have a specific set of facts and you give an opinion based upon specific set of facts, that's legal advice. On the other hand, if you're saying generically a trademark violation consists of the following characteristics, generically, that's legal information. So what you're talking about is legal. You could be creating a lawyer-client relationship. You subject yourself to a lawsuit for the, giving advice.
Hang on. No. I think this is very pertinent. Does this distinguish between public forms of social media communication and private forms, such as a Facebook chat or MSN Messenger? Because I believe a lot of people, you know, you chat with your friends and your family, and they ask you legal questions.
All the time.
Isn't it awful?
So is there a difference between the public forums and the private forums, was the question.
And the answer to that is no. Legal advice is legal advice. You know, I always use the example of you're at Thanksgiving dinner with a relative and they want to talk about their housing problem and you think you're just being nice by giving them advice. You actually know very little about housing, but you tell them, look, I don't really know very much, but, and then you give them advice. That's legal advice. And it doesn't matter whether you do it in a chat room, whether you do it on Facebook, or whether you do it at Thanksgiving dinner. You shouldn't be engaging in that kind of legal advice. You subject yourself to potential liability.
Right,
now,
I got to tell my wife I'm canceling.
It's often different, of course, if you're with relatives and friends, right? I mean, we have, you know, your disclaimers may mean more, but merely giving a disclaimer to someone either at the gym or at the Thanksgiving table does not mean you wouldn't be held liable. And I always look at this from, as I say, the risk perspective. What's the liability to you for being wrong? When are you going to get sued?
And family members tend to be litigious.
I mean, some of this stuff really is how many angels can dance, not
precisely
on the head of the pin, but on the point of the pin, because
precisely
because someone asks you a question at Thanksgiving dinner, you say, well, don't take this as legal advice,
right.
But if that's not a sufficient disclaimer, what about if you say, look, I can't answer that question because I don't want to create an attorney-client privilege. But let me give you a hypothetical. Suppose that somebody had the following set of facts, and you just recite verbatim what the person told you. Under circumstances like that, the generic answer is blah, 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 yak, yak, yak.
So you're not going to invite me to your Thanksgiving dinner,
nope.
I hope, because that sounds
I don't think people talk like that at Thanksgiving dinner.
Ever.
Yeah.
But look. The point is, how risk averse do you want to be?
Right.
But, I mean, you know, do you want to do that? Or do you want to say, look, I don't want to answer that. Let me just tell you, you know, I this is not my field of law. I would suggest you go talk to Mr. So and So, who's a lawyer in this area. Better advice.
Let's take a look at case study number two, Facebook. Everybody has a Facebook page. I actually ran into the one person on the planet the other day in my in-house firm has. No Facebook account.
Oh, I know
account.
A lot of people.
How many people actually have a Facebook account? Again, still the vast majority. You know, just your stalker profile.
Commercial.
Obviously informal poll of folks who have Facebook versus a LinkedIn account. I tend to find more professionals want to have a LinkedIn account and we'll get to a separate nuance on what the case study on LinkedIn. But Facebook, people really view that as really more social media. I want that to be separate and apart from that which I do for my profession, especially for the legal profession. But let's say you're on Facebook and your client is on Facebook. Let's say you are not necessarily. But they want to sue their nine-year-old niece for injuring his arm during a holiday party. Sound familiar? So he asks you if it's okay for him to remove his Facebook page photos of him arm wrestling with his trainer a little earlier that day. So is the answer no, and to avoid any potential for a later claim of destruction, the photo should also be preserved elsewhere. No, because the removal may be deemed destruction or spoliation of evidence, since litigation is anticipated. or the C. He should remove the photos immediately so his claim against the 9-year-old will be likely to succeed. Or is the answer C. He can remove them, but he has to ensure the photos are maintained. What do you think?
These are MPRE questions. No one in this room is passing it. No, I'm kidding.
Take down or not take down? Really, like, can you advise your client to go ahead and take down the photos? What do you think?
I think you take down the Facebook site or maintain the photo.
Maintain the photo. So you're thinking D. Anybody else think D? That sounds like the better of the answers. Yeah, I see lots of heads nodding in the room. So
let me just say, there's a real caveat. This is one of the most difficult questions that comes up in criminal defense work all the time. It comes up in civil cases as well, totally dependent on state law. And depending on what spoliation is in your state, you've got to look at a statute or obstruction. You've got to determine whether taking down that site would constitute a violation of that statute, right? And you need to answer that question before you can decide what to do. Generically, D is right if it doesn't constitute a crime, because if you can anticipate litigation, at least there's case law, there are ethics opinions that say if you can anticipate litigation, you have to preserve the evidence. You don't have to preserve the website. But one has to be really careful here.
Can I just make one quick point there, because that's a point that shouldn't be lost, which is, this is one country with a lot of states.
Correct.
And what Professor Yaroshevsky just said is it was in there is it depends what state you're in. And so I think it's really important to remember that on pretty much everything being said here, while we are focusing maybe on New York a bit, and there's been references to New Jersey and Florida, the fact of the matter is that the answer could be different from state to state, depending on the rules and the way those rules have been interpreted, right?
And the answer is different from state to state. And to make it even more complicated, if you're, you know, let's say this is someone lives in New York and they have a house in New Jersey as well, you're sitting there contemplating where it is you're going to sue and you don't really know. You've got to look at both New York and New Jersey rules to determine what the law is in each of those states, what the ethics rules say in each of those states. They may be different because you ultimately may be bound by New Jersey's laws when you're sitting in New York thinking about where it is you're going to sue. We call this multi-jurisdictional practice.
Yeah, this is the one time where, and this is personal experience that you're about to get, this is the one time where being an ERISA lawyer is really good, because the only law we have to worry about is the federal law, which preempts state law. And it's just such a different world I live in that regard, where I look at one set of rules. There might be differing interpretations from jurisdiction to jurisdiction, but that's different than what the professor is saying. What the professor is pointing out is that the rules themselves are different, not just the interpretation.
And the laws, too.
Right, exactly.
But in New York, right now, provided it does not violate the substantive law, there is no ethical bar for you advising your client, take the photos down, or if prohibiting the client to advise them to do so. Right now, basically, the substance of what they posted is going to be preserved in cybersafe anyway, or on the person's user computer, which goes to the point of the gentleman who agreed to take it down but preserve it elsewhere. At the end of the day, taking down does not equate to removing it forever.
So C is the right answer?
And that,
D.
You don't use bleach bit to...
Bleach bit notwithstanding, which is, interestingly, he had mentioned Big Brother watching. I recently read from the National Archives and Records Administration. It sounds so innocuous, this RA. What they did was say the preservation in proper format. What they gave were the best practices to the various federal agencies on how to capture social media records. Those strategies include web crawling. So they have various web crawling and web capture tools. They have API programs that can go in and freeze various tools in the social media application. They have RSS feeds and aggregated manual methods that capture, and they also have built special media, social media has built special tools. There is an actual 25-page report that this National Archives Association has put out that discovers the ingenious ways that Big Brother can actually go in, freeze, and watch your online presence. So it does matter how you advise your clients, where you're advising your clients, and the duty to preserve, also in the proper format. This is what it gets to the issue of, it's there, if once it's out there, it's almost out there forever.
Mm-hmm. But let me make one point regarding the preservation. This sounds very arcane. I mean, in that particular fact pattern, there's a huge benefit to the client to being able to take it down, meaning that if the niece is not aware that he was arm wrestling with the trainer earlier, the niece is never going to know, by the way, can I see those pictures of your arm wrestling that you've preserved somewhere else? So there is, this is a real substantive question.
A couple of other things to note about, forgive this, likes to circle many times before I get to the next slide, uh-huh. which hopefully is this next slide.
There we go.
Client confidentiality rules apply even to social media communications, and that's a key thing to remember. If you are blogging, if you're on a website, if you're doing any type of communication that's public or you semi-private in nature, let's say you give your clients access to something like that, you still have to treat it as if it's an actual communication. And we talked about before, you can give responses to online reviews, they just need to be accurate and truthful and can't divulge any of your client confidences. And also it's key to start thinking about managing your client's expectation in terms of instant communications and chats. If you don't otherwise or your firm has a policy on responding to a client who sends you a text in the middle of the night, again, a lot of these communications aren't intended to be saved, and one of your responsibilities is to keep a record of the various communications that you have with your client. So it may be wise to think of, if you don't already have a policy or your firm does not, to devise of how you will react to clients and social media policies, and maybe have a ban altogether on instant communication, because it's actually easier to defend yourself, especially as against, you know, potential malpractice, if you know that you've already always communicated in a very set and easily recordable fashion.
You know, that's a significant point, the possible need to actually change the way you do business from what you might view as optimal as a result of trying to minimize risks under these rules. And I think that's a really good point. This is not just sort of sitting out there in the background as some technical, theoretical, you know, sort of backbone to the issue. This is something that might actually force you to not behave in the way you want to behave.
And especially with text. I mean, one of the problems is, think about this. You're in an international negotiation, right? Your office may have a policy against using text in an international negotiation. The client's expectation,
right.
though, is they want to hear from you immediately. That's the lawyer they want.
Right.
They don't want somebody who's going to say, I'll talk to you at 6 o'clock in the morning,
right.
your time, right? And so how do you do that? How do you remain conscious of the fact that you shouldn't be using text, because it's very easy to get a text, whatever it was, intercept
and want to respond immediately, not have the opportunity to have that thoughtful lawyer diligence. That's what they actually want to pay you for, as opposed to the 160 characters.
Yeah, on the other hand, they want an answer at that point. So that's the question of managing expectations. How do you do that? The first lesson is to be conscious that that's an issue, and it's really hard to do when you're in the middle of a heated negotiation.
I mean, this isn't news to anybody in the room, I wouldn't think, but I think people, when they ask a question, start to get antsy nowadays if the answer doesn't come back within the next somewhere between half hour and 4 hours.
Right.
I mean, that was certainly
right.
not the way it was
right.
even a short time ago.
Right.
I mean, people used to joke around about the rule being, you know, the 24-hour rule. I don't want to let a message sit, you know, past the same time next day. Well, I mean, boy, I think we've blown past that. I think you don't want to let the message sit for 18 minutes.
Can the client just waive the confidentiality and say to the attorney, please answer me the way I want to be answered. Don't worry, I waive any confidentiality issues.
And the answer technically is yes. So first of all, who is the client? Is the client sufficiently sophisticated that in retrospect, the court is going to say that client understood what it is that they were giving up, because it's always going to be construed against the lawyer, right? It's what the reasonable client expects, not what the reasonable lawyer did. So yes, you can do that, but once again, I would say to you, how risk averse do you want to be? If the sophisticated client says, I need an answer now, I understand this may not be the most secure mechanism, but I'm willing to take the risk of doing that. You have that in writing. You can go ahead and do that.
The other way of doing that is the legislature, the ABA, can do something like that. Say, we understand we're in a new world, and operating through email and text is just
Well, that's why we have ethics opinions, but remember, they're only opinions. It's not really legislation. It's an opinion that says, under these circumstances, it would be appropriate for a lawyer to request that a client waive the.
Well, in general, everyone should waive. I mean, in this day and age, when people are communicating through email, it should just be a general waiver.
So the point there from the audience, two points, was number one, should the ABA just move this along and help the process by clarifying these rules and maybe even advancing them to these waivers? And then the second point that was just made was, shouldn't everybody just waive?
Well, remember, you're not just waive. When you say waive, that means third parties are entitled to the information, right? That's what a waiver
that
means.
Several.
Right?
That
it's not.
Why?
It's not just I'll communicate with you. And I won't sue you, which is what you want. I won't sue you if somebody gets hold of that, right? You don't mean waiver. I just want to be clear. Waiver is third parties freely can get that information and use it, right? So, look, we could have an opinion that says, under these circumstances, the opinion with a sophisticated client with informed consent can agree to permit a lawyer to use this method that isn't secure. That's as far as an opinion would go.
If we could just pause here for station identification. For those of you who are attending via webinar and you're requesting CLE credits, please note the following code on your affirmation form. It is ethics, in all caps, 961. Again, the code is ethics, 961.
And let me just add to that, to the same question. The reason you have at the bottom of every email that lengthy disclaimer, this material is protected, attorney-client privilege, right, is so that a third party will understand that they're not to get that. You know, you can't put that on every text message. You might want to put that on every text message. Maybe that's the world we're going to go into. You can't put it on a Twitter feed, right? You can't do that, but that's the kind of thing you're talking about.
Unless you want that message to be the Twitter message.
Right.
There's a related question that clients and lawyers have to deal with, and that is when someone asks you a question, particularly in my field or Drew's field, tax, ERISA, the answer to everything is it depends. Or
right.
It's complicated, and the client, particularly younger clients or clients who are adopting the persona of private equity people, say, I just want the answer. You know, don't give me the complication.
It sounds like my law students.
So you have to, the same way you have to know how to deal with clients and know which clients are capable of handling that and understanding that it's an answer that has a lot of caveats and it needs follow-up, and which clients are just going to take it and run with it to their own detriment, the same kind of issue arises.
Any other questions, particularly on the Facebook point or just communications with clients? I did want to poll again, inform all the room. So how many people actually have a LinkedIn page? See, that's much better.
A lot more than Facebook.
A lot more than Facebook. And that is becoming really more the norm. And in particular, and that's why I think it would be useful for us to delve into a little of the case study number three, because a lot of people are unaware of this. And I'll give you my own personal horror story of a LinkedIn endorsement. So for whatever reason, my mother seems to think that in the insurance industry in which I work means also mining, agriculture, aviation. I think she just randomly decided that she would check some colorful amounts of boxes and put those as part of the many skill sets that I must have. I would tell you, when I say best lawyer, I can say that now because my mother said so. Well, according to some of the ethics opinions, I actually can't do that. I should actually be monitoring, and I'm going to encourage, after we go through this case study, all of you to actually monitor. It's really nice, Mom, that you think I'm doing such a great job, but I'm not doing all of those great jobs. I don't know anything about marine law. You have to actually take ownership of your page. So let's talk about this case study number three here on LinkedIn.
Please nobody tell her mother this. This is
Please.
Not good.
No,
by the way,
no more.
That statement, if you have to take ownership, that is not a unanimous view. There are other opinions that say we
fight about this.
Yeah.
Okay. So can you state in your LinkedIn profile that you're an expert in private equity financing or patent prosecution? So is the answer A? No, because you cannot hold yourself out as an expert on social media sites. Or is it B, no, it's a private equity financing, but yes to patent prosecution if you are admitted to the patent bar? Or is it C, yes, because you didn't use the label specialist? Or is it D, the ethical rules are unclear, so you should not state that, or if you do, you should be aware of the risk? Any takers? Is it A?
I think I would answer D to every question you could ever ask.
Not the right answer.
There you go.
And I'm limiting this because, again, as Alan pointed out, the rules will differ. I'm giving you what you need to know as a New York / some of you New Jersey lawyer. But mainly the response I would give to you to this type of question is, what is the New York ethics rule say to us on this question?
Is there a difference between a specialist?
Ah, see? Now you're getting to the heart of it.
Repeat.
So one of our attendees here pointed out, is like, is there a difference between saying you're an expert versus a specialist? And the answer is yes. According to the ethics rule, and maybe by my giving you the answer, you'll know which one of these it is, mm-hmm. A law firm or lawyer may not list services under the heading of specialties on a social media site unless certified as a specialist by an appropriate organization or governmental authority. Oh. Therein lies your rule. So you cannot state that you're a specialist or specialize in a particular field of law unless you have, and my favorite is, you better believe that there's no definition of appropriate organization or governmental authority. See, I like when they leave those things ambiguous, because therein lies the Robert and I always having these back and forth conversations about expert versus specialist, because the rules are unclear because they didn't define exactly what some of those key components are for you to be able to put yourself out there. So I can say I'm an expert in any of these topics because the word expert is not verboten. However, specialist is.
So let me just say, we amended the New York rules in 2011 to try to deal with this problem, because in other jurisdictions, for instance, you can be certified as a trial specialist, and you can put that on your stationery. You may have seen that. Florida certifies people, Arizona, other jurisdictions. Patent lawyers can be specialists, okay? New York once had the old rule, didn't have any organization specified that could deem you a specialist. We now have the rule that allows the ABA, the American Bar Association, to certify people as specialists in certain fields. Patents, easy, right? But for other areas, unless you're certified by that designated organization of the ABA, you cannot call yourself a specialist.
Isn't there a district court case from last fall or recently in Florida that throughout a similar Florida rule that said if you really are an expert, the bar is not allowed to tell. It is, if objectively you're an expert, the bar can't say you can't use that word.
That was a Florida case. Yeah. Yes, not New York. We don't have that in New York. But it's not expert, it's special. That's the term of art.
But even special, I mean, my own guess is that within 5 years this rule will disappear.
Perhaps.
I don't think the federal courts are going to tell.
Perhaps. This could be another challenge.
Yeah. So is this a rule that is confined to social media?
No, not at all.
Okay,
I'm sorry if you thought that. No, this is, as I started off, my overview is these generic rules, they are generic. And social media just adds a little wrinkle to everything else. It's the same analysis.
Yeah.
But the question is, my mom's picking Marine as an endorsement for me. Does that now mean I told her, or I'm implying to the rest of the public, that I specialize in maritime law? Don't know. So that's part of the, here's some of your best practices. Take it down. If you know you're not doing it, you've never practiced before the SEC, although she believes I do, or the DOJ or anything. If you're not done any of those things, please just remove it. It was like, slightly, you know, say to mom, like, you know, sidebar, little chat, thanks, but congrats, I don't do any of those things. The key is you can have personal media, social media profile. So those are always going to be acceptable. But once you sort of put yourself out there as having certain skill sets, working in certain environments, a lot of us use this as part of our networking tool. It's a networking tool, but it also has these potential ethical implications for us as well. So some of these hybrid accounts make us fall into that arena. Yes, ma'am.
If there are no damages because no one is actually going to hire you as a Marine specialist, that doesn't matter.
It won't matter. So, the question is, if there are no damages, because no one's actually going to hire me as a Marine lawyer, is that the issue?
Well, one, there may be damages because someone may come along, maybe not Marine, but some other field, and like the way she looks on LinkedIn and hire her. So I wouldn't assume there are no damages. But you're talking about litigation. There are damages in terms of potential liability under the ethics rules. You could be found to be disciplined. You could be disciplined for violating Rule 7.1.
Even if nobody calls you on the solicitation, just the fact that it's out there.
Correct. Yeah. Well, and the wrinkle, you know, I say social media adds wrinkles. When you put an ad out there in a newspaper, no one else is going to tinker with it. LinkedIn, on the other hand, you're soliciting. If you're soliciting commentary and people are putting up, like Yelp, right, the Yelp for lawyering, right, they're putting up comments.
You're not soliciting commentary. I mean,
you might, you know, you could be soliciting. I don't know if you are or not.
I've had a LinkedIn account for I don't know how many years. I've personally never, ever, I can't document this, but I can say truthfully, never, ever asked anybody to post an endorsement of me for any field, yet numerous, maybe it's not quite admiralty they put up, they don't put that, but numerous people put stuff up, some of which is relevant, some of which is less relevant, some of which is irrelevant, and I've never asked for it, I've never used it, I've never used a LinkedIn account to advertise, I've never told people, if you want to see how much people like me, go to my LinkedIn account. I don't think I'm soliciting.
I don't think you're soliciting either, but you could see how it could become solicitation. Sorry.
My only comment was a practical one, which is when somebody looks to endorse you, you get the right to say yes or no. At least I've seen it. That's what I've seen on my account. They say such and such would like to endorse you for the skill. Do you want that or not?
One of the comments made from our audience members. She pays for the premium LinkedIn page.
So wait, so the comment being made is that in the attendees' experience on LinkedIn, that there's actually the ability of the owner of the page to decide whether or not the endorsement.
Accepting endorsement.
I thought that was a general proposition, but this is in my case that you get the right. You don't have to, like,
actively take it. I just get a notice saying so-and-so has endorsed you for admiralty law.
Yeah. And you have to go in and say, sorry, Mom, I know nothing about, you know, eminent domain. Yeah. Just like anything like that.
But you're in control.
You're in control of the page.
I tried to. LinkedIn.
A couple of other advertising rules sort of interrelated to this. Monitor your page. Monitor anything that you're putting out there that's going to have you as Esquire. Making sure that you can always, and we talked about the $50 AVO question, if you give me a rating, that type of thing on AVO, does that constitute any type of advertising solicitation? And you know, the rule is, you know, you as long as you don't tell them, like, make sure it's a 5 or whatever the rating ranking system is for AVO, something like that would be permissible. But the key on your advertising rules, your tweeting, your blogging, your chatting, anything that's character limited, you still have to use these disclaimers, attorney advertising or some abbreviation thereof. Prior results do not guarantee, you know, a similar outcome. You see, these are like taglines. We should like walk around with a T-shirt on with these things. So it's very clear that what we're talking about. So my vote, my vote on those two disclaimers, since we live in a world of emoticons, I vote as a profession that we just create an emoticon for those two things, like one just being like a little gavel and the other one being. So if anyone has any marketing tips that they'd like to put out there for these two things, I want two little emoticons, and that just wraps around what I want to say on a legal basis. I'm sorry.
Let's say you publish an article in the law journal, and then you attach to your LinkedIn.
You can repeat
it. Hey, you might be interested in looking at this article that's published in the law journal. Is that advertising? Do you put any advertising for that?
Mm-hmm.
If you don't say, I'm great, so look at it, you just say, hey, share this article, I just got published.
The question is, without self-congratulating, can you put a link to an article that you've written on your page and direct people to what you've written?
The answer is yes, but it might be considered an ad at some point. Depends how much you put up. If you just put up an article, maybe not. You put up an article and then you include other information that would get to the point where they might consider it an ad. There's not a good answer to that question.
And let the record show that the attendee who asked that question was very frustrated by that answer.
For good reason, because look at the contrast. I mean, all, you know, the advertising rules have been criticized on a whole host of bases. One of them is the people who get punished are people in small firms. They're the ones who put ads on the subways. They're the ones who put ads in newspapers. If you work for a large firm, what you have is a tasteful website, and you have materials that get sent out by mail to potential clients and other clients with articles, with pieces that people have written. Nobody considers that advertising. That's just good marketing and branding, right? And so there's always the critique of the large firm versus the small firm. That's what this feeds into.
There's a question.
Yes, I'm intrigued by Robert's point in terms of the distinction between what you post versus what others post on your page that you have not sought and really are absolutely indifferent as to whether it appears there. I could see in a LinkedIn situation maybe it's a closer call, although I would tend to decide more with Robert's position that, you know, you didn't ask for it, you didn't post it. But what about on Facebook? You know, you get an email that reminder, you know, it's Vivian's birthday today.
And it is. Thank you.
It is?
Really? Did you know that? I don't believe that.
I gave $50.
Okay.
So if I were to say happy birthday, and by the way, I saw your court appearance last week and you were the best, what, if any, responsibility did that now impose on you?
So one of our attendees queried, what if on my Facebook page someone said, happy birthday, oh, and by the way, I saw you in court and you were absolutely fantastic, the best. I'll just, you know, extrapolate on that.
Signed your mother.
Yeah, exactly. Signed, wonderful attendee. So what responsibility do I have on the Facebook setting to do anything with it? If it's not BDW Esquire on my Facebook page, and I otherwise, just from getting a congratulations from you, you're just congratulating me. That is not making a recommendation, making a referral. There's no special tab listing. I was like, everyone who just wants to say happy birthday to me, please use this column. Everyone else who wants to say anything about how great my skills are, use this. There's no differentiation in Facebook. You're just making a general comment about, you know, how great my oratory skills are. So great, you know, you can say that. I don't think I have any responsibility in the Facebook context there to go and take something like that down.
A Facebook page is not an advertisement. You know, remember I started with this question of branding versus advertising. If I have this coffee cup with our with our, you know, logo on it from our firm and I give everybody a coffee cup, that's branding, that's allowing people to know who we are, much like a Facebook page is, much like LinkedIn. LinkedIn is also not an ad unless. And then you fill in the dots as to what the unless is. And the less is, well, now I start putting up information about the kinds of cases I do. And now I start posting my articles. And now I start indicating this is my specialty, right? Then you're moving much closer to it becoming an advertisement. Advertisement is defined, if you will, as attempting to seek clients for the purpose of business, to make money, essentially. Right?
So to take the Facebook analysis and apply it to LinkedIn, if I have a bland LinkedIn page,
right, it's not an ad.
You know, here's my picture, here's my name, here's where I work, here's where I went to school.
Correct.
And then someone endorses and says, oh, he's great in, you know, international negotiation. What, if any, responsibility?
So let's just repeat that. It's a bland LinkedIn page which has nothing much saying much about anything, and then all of a sudden that LinkedIn page gets an endorsement. What is the responsibility to monitor and address the endorsement?
So lawyers have a responsibility of due diligence in many ways that you might not like, right? And one of them is monitoring what's out there about you, monitoring your LinkedIn page. So you have an obligation. I think the bar would say that, the monitoring that particular page. If that's out there, you need to look at it and see if you think it's accurate. If it's not accurate and you're advertising marine science, then it shouldn't be there. Then you need to exercise some control over what's on your LinkedIn page, because you don't want to be in the position of it being deemed an advertisement. So then you have to comply with Rule 7.1. And as I said, I encourage all of you to read its many multifaceted requirements.
But Professor, you just said two things there. One is make sure it's accurate, and the other is you don't want it to be advertising.
Well,
take Vivian's case. She'll take off the stuff about marine law. She'll take off the stuff about admirals or whatever. And then the rest of the stuff is so-and-so has endorsed Vivian for insurance law. So-and-so has endorsed Vivian for negotiation. And those are things where it's absolutely accurate. She does that, and does she have to consider that advertising and put a long disclaimer there?
It's not advertising because the point of LinkedIn is much more like the coffee cup at this point, right? It's more branding. You're just out there generically like other lawyers so that people can know who you are.
Okay.
You're not attempting to solicit particular business.
Okay, and that's a very useful guideline.
I think this is a great segue into talking about ratings and comparisons and comparative analysis. I lead off with this, our case study number 4 and the last, where we talk about best lawyers. You have a billboard ad in your online campaign states that you're ranked number 1 in the tri-state area for almost every field of law because you have my mother. And you don't need to investigate that ranking before you use it, do you? Is the answer A, no, because the number 1 speaks for itself? Or is it B, no, because this is a bona fide professional rating and you are allowed to use it in any ad? Or is it C, yes, because you must assess the methodology used to determine your rating and find that it is unbiased, non-discriminatory, and defensible process if you plan to use it? Or is it D, yes, because the regulatory authorities consider most ratings to be per se deceptive? So, any takers? I'm going with answer A, because number 1 speaks for itself. Anyone have a different answer to billboard rating you number 1 in the tri-state area for every area of law? Robert?
The answer that kicks the can down the road, as Drew and I will discuss, is C, which is as long as you can correctly determine that the rating is an unbiased, non-discriminatory, and defensible process, you can use it. And if there is anyone in this room who has the confidence in determining that something is unbiased, non-discriminatory, and defensible, I have several bridges on the East River to sell you.
Oh, they're all lovely. I turn the program now over to Drew.
Yeah, I'm going to turn it over to Robert with just one quick comment, which is that I think what you're going to hear Robert and I talk about now with respect to attorney ratings, I think so much of what's been discussed, actually even maybe more than I would have anticipated, is going to run through what the two of us are about to chat about. So with that, Robert, over to you.
Yeah, as most of you know, and the report is in your – well, first of all, let me thank everybody here for participating as an audience in the last hour, because I think we all share the view that, and we hope that you'll continue that, the more discussion we have, the more back and forth, the better we can get issues out on the table and advance them. The report that you have in the materials report came out approximately a year ago. One of the most important things I'll say, you see that right on the top of this slide, is neutrality of the report, by which we mean, in this report, Drew and I took absolutely no position on whether it is a good thing or a bad thing that these ratings exist, and we took no position on which of the various rating services, and you know, we're familiar with Chambers, Best Lawyers, Super Lawyers, there are others. We took no position on whether the methodology of this service is better or worse than the methodology of that service. And the main reason there are two reasons we took no position. First of all, because the two of us have radically different views, as we found out, on whether these things are useful and whether people should rely on them or not. You know, Drew is a believer in them, properly used. Many of the large firms in New York especially take the effort to make sure that they're properly represented and portrayed. I, on the other hand, have been a consumer of legal services most of my career, and I can tell you I've never been listed in any of these things, at least not to my knowledge. I've never sought to be listed. I've never hired a lawyer based on these things, and most of the lawyers whom I've hired
are people who say they couldn't care less about them. So there are radically different views on whether they're useful or not. We took the position they're there, people do use them, so let's proceed on that. The other reason why it was important to be neutral, and we'll get into this a little bit more in terms of terminology, ratings versus rankings, there are many people within the higher echelons of the state bar in New York, in corresponding organizations elsewhere, and in the courts who have real serious concerns about whether these are good or bad. And we determined pretty quickly that this report would never have seen the light of day in view of how the executive committee felt if we took any substantive position on whether they're good or bad or which ones are good or better.
Yeah, it's very hard to build consensus over the use of ratings. I mean, there are people that, I mean, putting aside, you know, Robert's sort of skepticism about ratings, there are people that really hate them. I mean, that more than Robert, who is sort of characterizing as, you know, so who cares? I mean, there are people that really don't like them. So when we got the idea to do this report, we immediately realized that it wasn't even going to be, and Robert correctly points out that he and I don't even agree, it was not even going to be worth the candle to try to build consensus. Rather, it was more from the perspective, as Robert said, of, you know, they're out there, and when I throw it back to Robert, we're going to talk about this. You know, do we want these things, do we want these ratings used as best they can be used, regardless of whether or not we think that they're a good idea? It's always better to have them used more carefully and better, and that was what was motivating us. So, taking a half a step back here, so one of the things we wanted to accomplish in doing this report, not only is sort of just the foundational aspects of the report, was to collect and bundle up a wide range of authority, really across the country, that has to do with ratings. Now, one reason for that was to introduce the topic and really to set the table. Really, we wanted to present an overview of what the rating services are about as a general matter so that we can then sort of more cogently discuss what we thought of ratings. But there was a sort of an ulterior motive, a second reason, sort of something that I like to do in a lot of things that we do, which was to allow the report to serve as a source of citations, really so that people who find this topic to be interesting can really have access to a wide range of authority. I mean, we put a lot of stuff in here, and I do think that we captured a really good amount of authority, particularly from New York. I mean, that's sort of where we are. But also there are cases and other authority from Alaska, New Jersey, South Carolina, Utah, and the state of Washington. So if you're looking and trying to understand what people around the country in an adjudicative way are saying about this, then this report is a really nice place to look. Robert, I want to send it back to you now to get us into sort of the substance of what we did here in terms of, you know, approaching it from a best practices type of mentality.
Yeah, we'll cover this further in a slide or two, but with all of that in mind, what does this report do? It's got citations, but it also says best practices. It starts from the proposition that these services exist, these publications exist, they have lists of lawyers, they say things about the lawyers, they put them in bands, in tiers, whatever they might be. So from the standpoint of three different constituencies, which we will get to, what is the best way for a client or a potential client to think about these publications if you're sitting in the waiting room in a law firm or you come across it in a library, you're doing your homework, trying to select a lawyer, and you see this publication? What's the best way to think about it, and how should a lawyer describe to the client when the client says, hey, I see you were listed in such and such service, what does that mean? The second one that we're going to get to is how should the lawyers interact with it? What's appropriate, what's not appropriate in terms of a lawyer interacting with the services and being a part of the process by which these ratings are put together? And the third is, and this is more aspirational than anything else because we obviously have no control over any of how it's put together, if you're a publisher, what do we have to say about what publishers ought to do? What would we like to see as a profession, or at least as a committee, what would we like to see the publishers do in terms of putting their reports together and what they say about their reports?
Yeah, we did not try to really delve into the question of the ethical ramifications of these ratings and the use of these ratings, which you've heard a lot about already, in the context of social media and otherwise, we really were just trying to get best practices out from sort of a non-technical perspective. Before I go on, I just want to make sure that neither one of you wanted to jump in with any observations or commentary.
Well, I will just say that this report was terrific. I sit on a number of committees that had to consider the report and what we ought to do about it, and they did a great job. It's very thorough.
I did not know she was going to say that. If I had known it, I certainly would have been sure to turn it over to the professor. Okay, so now we just heard about case study number 4, which was the best lawyers case study, and so before we get to best practices, that sort of loops into this sort of moment here, this segment, which is to talk about one particular piece of authority. So one of the key New York ethics opinions, and again, I just got through saying that we did not decide what the ethical ramifications are, but we did give foundational background. And one of the key pieces of foundational background here was just to sort of relay what the ethics opinion, what this particular ethics opinion did. One of the key ethics opinion in this area from the Bar Association's, the New York State Bar Association's Committee on Professional Ethics, which I'll refer to as the CPE, was opinion 1007-1007 in 2014. There, the CPE dealt with the question of whether a lawyer can advertise the lawyer's inclusion in Best Lawyers, which is one of the more widely disseminated rating services. And a lot of what I'm about to say now is going to resonate from some of the stuff that Vivian just talked about. The main concern was that a lawyer's referencing of a Best Lawyers listing to a potential client could amount to a claim of superiority in comparison to other lawyers, really without a basis in objective criteria. That was the concern. If that were so, if that were true, that's not a good thing. And as some additional background here, one of the official comments to the ethics rules, and again, this was just sort of gone through, says that a rating is not to be considered bona fide unless it is unbiased and non-discriminatory. So that sort of lays the groundwork. Now, to decide this question, the CPA actually went ahead and did research. They got factual information from Best about its ratings procedures. But while it did get that information, at the end of the day, and I'm going to go to Robert's kick the can comment, at the end of the day, the CPE left it up to the lawyer to decide whether the rating services methods were unbiased, non-discriminatory, and defensible. The CPE ultimately concluded that a lawyer may advertise inclusion in Best if an assessment of the methodology used to determine inclusion reveals that the methodology is, and I quote, an unbiased, non-discriminatory, and defensible process. So, what that's telling you is, lawyer, understand what it is that's happening with the rating service in question as best you can before you go use it. So I think Robert's kick the can comment is right there. So that's sort of a good lead-in, I think, to our discussion now of best practices, right? Because now we've got the CPE basically saying, hey, lawyer, get educated, understand what you're talking about. So at least to the CPE, it's up to the lawyer to make some kind of assessment of a rating service before promoting the lawyer's own rating. So with that, Robert, let's go back over to you for what these rating services are really about and start taking us through a discussion of how we view best practices.
Right. Before we do that, I mean, people bandy around terms, and when we started talking about this within our committee, we were using the term ratings, we were using the term rankings, and one of our committee members pointed out, no, there's a real big difference between ratings and rankings. And ultimately, there is. Let me give you an example. How many people here are sports fans?
Oh.
To any degree. Baseball, football, golf, it doesn't matter. Okay. Okay. Everyone's familiar then with books and publications. Here are the 100 best quarterbacks ever to play in the National Football League. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Here are the 100 best baseball players, right? This will date me a little bit. You could argue that is Mantle better than Mays, but Snyder wasn't as good as either one of them. Okay. For those of you who are a little younger, Ron Swoboda wasn't as good as either one of them.
Excuse me. You got one chuckle in the audience. Why?
Okay, okay. Rankings, ratings are what this report is addressed to, which is, and maybe a difference of degree more than kind, but it's narrative, methodologies, maybe putting people in bands or tiers. Here are the 10 top people based on their peers. Here are the next 10, et cetera, first tier, second tier. Rankings are trying to reduce the quality of a lawyer, or for that matter, of a law school, and we all know how pernicious that can be when you choose a law school, you'll choose number 31 rather than number 32.
Uh-huh.
But there was extreme opposition in the executive committee to the idea of the existence of rankings. How in the world can you say this law firm is number 2, this law firm is number 3, or this is 10 and this is 12? Granted, if you're 2, 3, 10, or 12, there's probably good reason why you're 2, 3, 10, or 12 relative to the law firm ranked 400.
Mm-hmm.
But that's not what we're talking about. We're talking about the very close distinctions that become meaningless. So this report is not about rankings at all. It's about ratings. It's about the services that we've been referring to that take the time and effort to poll people and don't just try to reduce everything to a numerical score.
By the way, I just want to make one anecdotal comment there. I mean, I have a kid who was looking at colleges, and pretty smart kid. I mean, you know, he's solid. He's good. I didn't say more than that. I just said solid. And we were looking at schools, and we were sort of comparing school A to school B. And he said, no. I'm much more interested in school A. It's a better school. And I said, really? I really wasn't aware. What do you mean? And he literally said, well, this one is 32, and this one is 33. And this is one ranking, really the one that's out there. So it's got several foibles here. One is that it's one ranking, and two, it was that it was literally one slot. And I think that goes to Robert's point as to the sort of the heightened dangers of an actual numerical list as opposed to a banding or collection. And the state bar, the people that we were dealing with on this were extreme. There was varying degrees of concern about ratings, but there was heightened concern about rankings.
Yeah, and rankings is for two reasons. First of all, because it's absurd to say that this firm is 32 and this firm is 33. It's meaningless. But also because when you reduce something to something as definitive as a number, you imply that there's much more precision than there is, and the issue of bias, skewing, discrimination, and I don't mean invidious discrimination, but I mean the fact, and we'll talk about this some more, that are the inclusion and ratings biased towards the fact that if you're much more likely to be included if you're a big law firm than if you are a small law firm. You're much more likely to be included if you're in New York County than if you're in Herkimer County, and so on and so forth. You put a number on that, and that sinks somebody. That's why there was opposition to that.
So what's interesting to me about all of this is that if you look at AmLaw, when you're rating law firms, and our law students look at law firms, they're rated on a whole host of factors, including how much pro bono work is there, you know, and then they're numbered. And we do that for law firms, so why is this so different?
But that's raw statistics. In other words, if somebody is willing to put out statistical information that's either based on verifiable numbers or based on peer review that is based on underlying facts, I don't think we would have had the same response from the committee, or from the executive committee. But when you basically say, I mean, I'll just pick out two names. Is Cleary Gottlieb or Davis Polk a better firm? There's no way to answer that
question. Well, there is. You could come up with data and say for bankruptcy, these are the five best firms in the city, and here are the data that support
We
could do that.
Right, but that gets more into the ratings than trying to say, if there are 1,000 law firms in New York, I'm going to list the top 1,000 law firms, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, et cetera, for bankruptcy.
And putting aside whether one is right or wrong about whether or not one could do a ranking, and there's a difference, I think, between like profitability numbers, which is more objective as compared to who's the best pro bono firm, which is more subjective, and put the profitability stuff aside completely because that is just a numerical thing. But like go back to your pro bono rankings thing in the American Lawyer. For better or for worse, our committee wanted us to go nowhere near that. there was just a real heightened concern about subjective rankings that ultimately resulted in a numerical list. And that's sort of what just we're really reporting on that rather than commenting on it.
Yeah.
I'm just tweaking you because I live in the world of law schools that get ranked.
Oh yeah.
All the time,
oh, absolutely.
Which is disturbing.
But that precipitated it because it was the same publication that is known for ranking law schools was, to use the word of one former head of the Bar Association, threatening to rank law firms, and he swung into action and prevented it.
Correct.
Right. Right. Yeah, just again, the point here being that the Bar Association and others, obviously, are specifically tuned in to concerns about rankings that even transcend generic concerns about ratings.
Okay. So let's go right into what the report does. As we said, it's recommended best practices, and we're going to go through the three areas for existing clients and potential clients. That's one area used by attorneys and used by the agent, or how the agencies themselves should, at least in our hopeful view, behave.
Yeah, so that's just terrific background, Robert. Thank you. So what kinds of considerations, what are the kinds of considerations that clients, both potential clients and existing clients, might want to take into account before making use of an attorney's inclusion in a rating service? First, and again, this is just with trying to get, you know, sort of concepts, what would help in using these services. There can be differences in approaches here depending on whether the client is trying to hire completely new counsel or is looking to hire an existing firm for a new area of work. That's an important contextual point. In the latter case, for a new area of work, there may be greater familiarity with the law firm and its personality already as a whole. So the context may be very different as compared with the context for a whole brand new hire. And I think one of the things we try to do in this report is to point out, you know, context, context, context. Be careful. It's not one size fits all. It's different considerations for different circumstances. Now, for potential clients in particular, we thought that the prospective client should really be careful to understand just what the ratings do purport to mean. Different rating services may be trying to say different things. They're not the same. Some of them may be almost a popularity contest. What are people saying in a poll? Others may be real, live, hard research as to, you know, sort of trying to get a substantive view as to really what's happening with the attorneys. And their criteria and data collection efforts may be very, very different, so that in looking at rating service X, you're not necessarily getting the same thing as compared to when you're looking at rating service Y. And in any event, now this is, I think, a point, I think, Robert, frankly, I think this was really a point that you emphasized, and I think it's right. Third-party ratings should never be the be-all, end-all. It should not be just, hey, I'm trying to pick an attorney, this attorney's on the list, this attorney isn't. And that's the end of my inquiry. I'm not looking further. We caution against that in the report. The ratings should be at most one of the factors that goes into the process of attorney selection. And indeed, it really may make sense for the client to ask the attorney what the attorney thinks in terms of the comparisons being made to other attorneys. Whether the attorney is included in the list or not, it might be nice to solicit the attorney's own view as to how these things fit together. And more generally, we thought it would be a good idea for the client to talk with the attorney about ratings and what they might or might not mean. That attorney's own ratings, taking note of things like, what is the attorney's experience and capacity? Not just what's the rating. How will the services be performed? Where will the services be performed? Don't get seduced, if you're the client or potential client, don't get seduced by just that the rating is there. So we try to go out there and try to send some messages to the clients as to how they might use these ratings. What are likely fees and disbursements? What are billing protocols? These are things that we thought might be important to the client and, you know, therefore, by extension, thought might be important for the attorney to be willing to talk to the client about. What are references and other backgrounds relating to the potential retention? So, again, trying to get away from just what the rating services are saying and try to get behind that with a little additional information. Also, what about the client's analysis of the client's own level of sophistication, particularly in the context of the type of retention being considered? Is it a criminal matter or a civil matter, a big matter or a small matter, other aspects, et cetera, et cetera? Does the client have a firm grasp of the client's own ability to consider all relevant items and to make a good selection decision? And should the client get more educated regarding the retention process even before making the decision to retain any particular lawyer. And if, in fact, those things are important, if the lawyer can agree that those things are important, then should the lawyer, not as a matter of necessarily being required to do so, but as a best practice, should the lawyer hold the client's hand through this, and should the lawyer help the client worry about it? And I'll do now my quick CLE moment here, which is the following. For those webinar attendees requesting CLE credit, please note the following code on your affirmation form, rating 123. Again, the code is rating 123, and what I'm reading, rating is capitalized. I don't know whether or not that's important, and I'm being told that it's not. Rating 123. And where we're specifically talking about a current client using an existing attorney for a new type of project, there is an additional overlay in that it may be easier for the client to talk to the attorney because of the existing relationship. So take note of that contextual point. Where the attorney-client relationship has been a positive one, ratings, quite frankly, may just be a lot less relevant as a practical matter. There's already something there. There's a foundation there. But where the project, now caution here, where the project really involves new topics or may even be, or maybe even new legal personnel within the firm, an expanded inquiry may actually turn out to be worthwhile even where the client already knows the firm. So these are just things that occurred to us that could be relevant to the way that this is being pursued from the client's perspective, and I think that to the extent that it might be relevant from the client's perspective, we wanted to tune the attorneys into it as well. And before I go on, I'm going to see if there's anything that people want to dive in on, anybody.
Just one comment. You have to, as an attorney, you have to be sensitive that one size doesn't fit all.
Right.
If a client comes in and makes a point of saying, I was very impressed by the fact that you were listed in the following three publications as one of the really, really good practitioners in this field, you ought to feel a little bit more of a responsibility. We're recommending it. You ought to feel a little bit more of a responsibility to make sure that that is not in any way misleading the client than if the client says, you know, I got a recommendation from so-and-so who was very happy with your representation of her last year and makes no reference whatsoever to the fact that they even check one of these things.
What does that mean? I mean, the client comes in and says, I saw you in Best Lawyers, great photo, everybody looks great, you had a whole page, and you're highly recommended, so that's why I want to hire you. What do you say?
Give them a retention letter. No, it's just...
Right, exactly. What is it that you think the client has to know?
I do think that if you really have reason to believe that it's all just about the Best Lawyer listing, and you're worried particularly that the client may be unsophisticated, I mean, I know that this is going to be sort of counterintuitive, and I'm not suggesting that this is going to happen very frequently as a real-world matter, but you have to wonder at some point whether or not the attorney says, look, I you know, appreciate my best inclusion, I do, but I just, you know, want to be clear. It's not the only factor. It isn't definitive. Is an attorney likely to really say something like that?
Absolutely
I
not.
Suspect not. But is it something that should at least be in the attorney's head? Look, the attorney shouldn't want the potential client misled. I know the attorney should want the retention, but the attorney in a perfect world should want the retention for the right reasons. And I think that if you handle this correctly, if you're the attorney, you can impart significant cautionary information to the prospective client without losing the retention. And frankly, if you do, could make the retention even that much stronger and could even get you more respect in the eyes of the client or potential client. Again, am I pretending to think that that's the way it's really going to happen across a host of cases? No. Am I suggesting that it's possible that there will be a case where an attorney who's really focused in on this will sort of hold the client's hand through this and make sure that everything's just so and just right?
Then there's no need to have these ratings at all.
No. I don't think that's true because I think it's a factor. I think it could be a relevant factor. The fact that one's peers has placed an attorney into, and Robert and I might disagree on this, but from my perspective, the fact that one's peers have caused an attorney to be included on the list, or the fact that a ratings organization that does research has chosen to put the attorney into a certain place. I don't think that's an irrelevancy, but nor do I think it should be the end. If I were somebody who got I've had this happen. Where did you get my name? I got it from Best. I got it from Super. I got it from Chambers. If that's going to really lead to a retention, I actually might make the next comment, which is you know that that's not the end of the inquiry necessarily. I'm certainly happy that I've gotten that, but I just and that would be that if I saw that the client was really being led around by the nose, by the ratings.
But what about ads? I mean, I saw your picture on the subway. 1-800-LAWYER, and I really like your
Lawyer logo at the bottom.
Wait, do I have to do that as well?
It's the test is the one that Justice Stewart set out in Jacobellis versus Ohio. You know it when you see it. Sometimes you do.
That's really helpful.
Sometimes you do, sometimes you don't. I'll give you an example of when you really should walk away from a representation. I mean, if somebody came to me and said, you're a tax lawyer, right? Can you fill out my tax return? My answer would be yes, but you really don't want to pay my rates to do something that H&R Block will do for a lot less.
And I've had that conversation.
Yes, but that's different. That's different than advertising for a particular service or being listed in Best Lawyers for a particular service.
But these things, we've made the point in the report, these things are not as specific as you might like. So, for example, if somebody is listed as one of the best lawyers for white-collar crime, right, and we all know who some of the high-end people in that field are, and there's a guy who notices that and he calls up one of these particular stellar white-collar criminal lawyers and said, there's a minor accounting fraud in a private company. I'm being sued by, one of the owners. That lawyer is likely to say, yes, I was included in Best, but there's no way in the world that I'm the right lawyer to do this. You shouldn't be looking to pay my rates for it.
But I want to make one comment here because the professor said something really, really important here, which is, well, do you have to do that? Do you have to do this? What do you have to do? I want to be clear. We're not purporting to say what you have to do. We're trying to help with what we're calling either recommended or best practices, whatever the phrase you want to use is, to make these ratings work better in the interaction with the attorney-client retention. And so I don't think that we're pretending to know what one has to do. I think we're more trying to push people towards being sensitive to some of the aspects of the way in which these ratings might affect clients, might affect attorneys, and might affect the attorney-client relationship. So going on now, only because I think Robert and I, anybody that knows us knows that we could talk for all night and then tomorrow. So let's not do that, and let's move to considerations that the attorney, him or herself, might want to consider. What kinds of considerations might come up when you're talking about an attorney promoting the attorney's own rating, which I think is more what Professor Yaroshevsky was sort of getting to. Now first, and this may not necessarily be so obvious, an attorney really, in our view, should reflect in each particular situation on a threshold question. Is a lawyer's promotion of a rating really right for the situation? Again, this may be aspirational, you may chuckle, but that's something that we think is something that a lawyer should do. The lawyer may want to avoid situations where, for whatever reason, there is a greater likelihood that somebody may really be misled. I mean, I think that's sort of the self-evident thing to say. Again, I recognize people are trying to get hired. I get it. But still, if you're worried that your potential client is being misled by something, I mean, don't you want to at least think about addressing that? The level of sophistication of the client could be one of the relevant considerations there. Other considerations could include, will the communication be going out to an array of recipients, where some may be better equipped to understand what's going out there than others? I mean, that's something to think about. If the information is being put out there in a public or a general way, it may not even be possible or practical to provide any further clarification. So now the attorney needs to understand the information is out there, it's got a life of its own. Again, understand it. Worry about your potential client. Worry about the person who's about to hire you. Robert gave a couple of examples of where an attorney might say at the end of the day, look, if you want, I had a client once where I remember literally saying to the client, look, this is gonna cost you, I think, three times as much as what this would cost you with a colleague of mine who in your case I think will do just as good a job. And that particular person, to my great nervousness, said, I still want to hire you. Well, I'll tell you, I felt much better about that retention that I got that comment out there.
But not nervous that you were also making a referral to an attorney and that they may be relying on your referral?
They didn't ask for the referral. No, you stayed with
They stayed with you, but what if they said, you know what, you're right, I'm going to go with...
Well, that's going to get to a different point, which I'm not sure we're going to have time to address. That's going to get to the referral issue, which is a whole nother thing, so to speak, which maybe we'll have time for, and maybe we won't. But let's see if we do. It looks like we might. Hold that thought. And yet another thought, really, from sort of a slightly different angle, is the attorney may want to ask a new client if ratings were relevant to the retention process. Now, I'm getting at this from another perspective, which is the attorney's own marketing. Wouldn't it be nice to know that the listing in Best or Super or Chambers or whatever worked? Wouldn't it be nice to know what's going on out there? So that, for example, if you're talking to a client, say, oh, by the way, was it significant to you? And this is now not a question of worrying about the relationship. This is understanding what these ratings do or don't mean. Wouldn't it be nice if you knew? Look, it was a very material aspect of my decision to hire you, that you were listed in Super, that you were listed in Chambers, that you were listed in Best. Or, alternatively, I noticed the logo on your ad. Frankly, I couldn't have cared less. It's an interesting aspect and one that we point out in the report that it might be nice to know.
And there's no data. As we move toward an evidence-based culture and all other kinds of realms, we don't have data as to how people pick lawyers. Susan?
I just want to say, I'm not familiar with the best lawyers, but super lawyers and a lot of these others are just another whole thing. So they get lawyers to pay the money, to get classes with their office, to advertise in their network. I've been a super lawyer many years. I'm not going to tell you I'm the best lawyer in my field. Somebody recommended me, and someone keeps recommending me, or continue it, and I get bombarded with email about how much I want to spend in their book and stuff like that.
Okay.
I don't do that. There's a distinction between putting yourself in an ad that someone named you, because now you're going the next step and just being
okay, so the point from the audience, which is, it's actually remarkable how you're leading into the next thing that I was going to say, it really is. The point from the audience, by the way, maybe you're not the best, but you clearly are super. So the point now here was, when you are going through this process, there's a bilateral aspect to this. They list you and then sometimes solicit you for advertisement. They list you and sometimes would like to get you to pay them for something on the back end. Maybe that payment on the back end has nothing to do with whether or not you're included in the book. Maybe it does, depending on the organization, depending on the rating service. There's really not uniformity here. So I really want to get to this. This is exactly the right point, which is, this is a point about the attorney's own participation in the compilation of the ratings. The lawyer needs to be really careful to avoid providing any confusing information or in soliciting others to do so. There are some evidence out there that there are people that really push hard to get people to make recommendations and to say certain things. What if there's back scratching? What if you go to a person and you say, well, if you put me in the book, then I'll do X for you. If you give me a recommendation, then here's what I'll do for you, or maybe there'll be a recommendation or something else. You got to be very, very careful. And then now to get to the exact point you made, really be tuned in. If there's any kind of a pay-to-play, what the attorney should be doing is should be very, very, very careful about gaming the system. Now, I do want to respond to one point here. While there is undoubtedly, as the attendee just suggested, a sort of a procession of follow-on emails very often, now you're rated. Here's an advertisement you can place. Here's a plaque you can buy. That's out there. A lot of the rating services very clearly state that the question of whether or not you pay to get in or pay afterwards is not relevant to basic inclusion in the book. It may be relevant to the way in which the inclusion is done, as to whether there's bolding or color or whatever, but they're very clear
at least in some cases, I'm not pretending to speak universally, at least in some cases, that there is no pay to play. But these are all things to really understand and to know. If in fact somebody solicits you for a rating, and there is a pay to play aspect of it, so that if you pay, hey, I saw your rating in blank, and boy, they really must like you. You were listed in font that was 5 times larger than the font that was above or below you. And let's say that you know that that particular aspect of the listing was something that you paid for. Well, I think you really have to think long and hard. I don't know whether there'd be a requirement. There might be. But you at least have to think long and hard just from a best practices perspective as to whether or not you tell the client, oh, I'm very proud of my listing, but the way in which that listing was presented was actually affected by something that I purchased.
Part of your marketing.
But I don't think you want your client, your potential client, to be left unaware that that was an aspect, especially if you have reason to believe that that's relevant. I don't think you necessarily need to say, the instant your potential client sits down, hey, I wonder if you saw me in blankety blank service, and by the way, if you did, here's the details about, you know, where there was pay to play or where there wasn't. I don't think that's hard to believe that that would be necessary. But I do think it's wise to have an understanding of the way the various services put these things together and to be tuned in to where the client or potential client might be being misled. I mean, Robert, I want to throw it back to you for any comment there, and also for really maybe some messages for the rating services themselves.
Yeah, this leads into what we would love to see from the rating services, because it's a continuum of what the lawyer says about how it came to pass that the rating appeared in such and such a way in such and such a place versus what the rating agencies we would like to think ought to say. It would be very nice to be able to ascertain in public forum from the rating service, is their rating based on polling? Is their rating based on recommendations? Is there any kind of substantive review? But then also to get more granular, if they list 30 people, let's say, as the band number 10 and number 1, 10 and band number 2, 10 and band number 3 is the best practitioners in field X, how many did they filter out to get to those 30 people? Or did they just, you know, filter from 40 to 30? Or did they filter from 1,000 to 30? If each band happens to have 10 people in it, it would be nice to know where they stand relative to each other. You know, in band number 1, are there really 2 who are absolutely outstanding and everybody else is a cut below, but just for the sake of not making it look ridiculous, they put them into 3 bands. The basic recommendation we have to the services and to anyone who uses them is the same thing. More information is better than less. One final thing to mention, though, and this is important with the services also, it's important to know whether there are any safeguards, because no information is perfect. If somebody is listed in there, is there a safeguard against, you know, what happened 1 year in Major League Baseball where the Reds told their fans, vote for us, and the whole starting lineup of the All-Star game was the Cincinnati Reds. Is there any safeguard against gaming the system? Conversely, what happens if someone is not listed? Is there any safeguard against avoiding not being listed because someone put a real zinger in there and said you were awful? We don't know, and we didn't undertake a comprehensive survey, but it would be nice to know that. And it gets granular there also. For instance, not necessarily one of the lawyer rating services, but there is one of, you know, another service out there where I've read that if someone posts a negative review, the person about whom the negative review is posted can refund the money to the customer, and then the negative review automatically goes away. So negative reviews or the absence of negative reviews are thereby skewed. And same message, more information is better than less information. No one has any control over the rating agency services except for the fact that it takes a 47-cent stamp to start a libel action. Wow. But beyond that, who knows?
Going back to my point of getting rid of them altogether, I'll give you my one AVO example, which we discussed before this. Apparently, AVO will move your number up from, I think, the standard placeholder number is 5. if you agree to
6.5.
Yeah, 6.5. Oh, yeah. Awesome. Out of 10, if you agree to complete your profile, and then further, I guess you have to do some other payment for advertising or prettier font or pretty little color picture. But I got the cold call from Avvo asking, inquiring us, you know, what do you do? And it's like, oh, and the second I said, I'm in-house counsel, what, you know what, you really can use your click. What? Oh, so I'm going to sit at a 6.5, even though, as my mother knows, I'm really great at maritime law.
Yeah.
I'm never going to be rated highly because I can't potentially go out there and have a client. I'm in bed with my client. The rating services are not fair. I was like, if it fairly reviewed all lawyers, no matter where they sit, governmental law or in-house counsel, private practice, single proprietors, then I would say it makes sense. It's a great system, but the system right now is a business, as the woman put. It's a business. They're trying to raise money. This is not really about saying how great I am at what I do for a living.
But just to be clear, the report stays away from judgments like that. Stays away.
I don't.
That's fine. But I just want to be clear that the report does not go down this road. And I personally make no comment on whether or not these ratings are. I happen to think that they are okay. But I'm not trying to persuade anybody that they are. I think the message here, though, is that if they are going to be used by clients and attorneys alike, putting aside whether they are good, bad, or indifferent, if they are going to be used, these kinds of considerations, I think, are important to understand and know so that, you know, whether it's from the attorney's perspective, from the client's perspective, or from the rating services perspective, all of those, when the attorney understands the way those different dynamics play together, I think that the attorney then has a better chance of maximizing the legitimate value, to whatever extent there is legitimate value, of the rating services. And that's what the report really tries to do, is without being judgmental, to basically take it as it lays and say these reports, these services are out there. In this particular world, people are using them. How can they be used in a way that is more constructive? I think you have.
So, yeah, whether or not they have legitimate value, the point is we're putting an onus on the lawyers, on all lawyers, to look at the rating services to make sure that their methodology is accurate methodology. And New Jersey recently went as far as to say, if you're going to say you're a super lawyer, you have to give the client at the bottom of your ad a way for them to be able to determine the methodology that super lawyer used or best lawyers. How the heck do you do that?
Yeah. That was my comment about the bridges. It just puts the onus on the lawyers to do a task that is going to be judged at some point by somebody incorrect with 20/20 hindsight.
But it's also true that if you can't, I mean, I don't see how you could post, go to super lawyers, whatever, to find out how they do it. If you can't do that, then you're basically in New Jersey prohibiting lawyers.
There's probably some, at least theoretical ability, to direct one without, to an overview by the rating service, in at least in some cases, as to how they do what they do. They're clearly not going to want to give away their intellectual property, but I think that there will be, at least in many services cases, there will be some very high-level sort of recitation of what's done. I'm sure, at least in two or three cases that are in my head, I don't want to mention specific services, but I know that they go out there, and not with great specificity, but with some high-level amount of information, go out there and say, here's how we do what we do.
And we did share with you in your materials that a recent New Jersey notice. They went out to their bar and said, you cannot use these accolades and awards unless you verify them and you know that the organization has made an inquiry into the fitness of the lawyer's character.
Like, and you have to give people the way to find that out.
And you have to give them a way to find it out. So,
all right. Listen, we're going to see if there's any questions from the audience. Before we move on to wrapping this up, if there aren't, we may have one, two, or three. I think we do have. No? Any questions from the audience? There's nothing online. Any questions? Okay. In our last two or three minutes, because people want to see Elia that we promised, why don't we just give it to Robert to just try to do a very high-level overview of referrals. Robert, over to you.
Yeah, I mean, historically, and this goes back even before I started practicing, historically, referrals were a fun thing. You referred somebody to a colleague, and you got a third of the fee, and that was all that was required. For decades now, and I think it's Rule 7.2, if you're going to make a referral and you're going to get a fee, there are certain requirements that have to be observed. The principal requirement is you have to be doing something in order to be allowed to take a referral fee. And the something, I believe, is either A or B. A is you have to be doing an appropriate amount of the work to justify the referral fee. So, for example, if there's an initial public offering and I'm a tax lawyer and I refer it to a buddy of mine who's a securities lawyer, if I do the tax work and he does the securities work, I can take a referral fee. And there's always a little bit of play in terms of no one necessarily checks exactly how many hours, but it has to be a reasonable split of the work. The other possibility is if you take joint representation, joint responsibility for the representation, you're allowed to take a referral fee. And I analogize this certainly in my own mind to the fact that in a multi-attorney law firm, the partners split the profits because ultimately they're all responsible in some sense for the work that each of them does. Now, with the advent of limited liability partnerships, you can ask questions about that. But the idea is if you have joint responsibility, you're also allowed to take a referral fee. And finally, one other requirement for referral fees is the fee has to be reasonable. In other words, the fee can't be higher because someone's getting a referral fee. Well, it can be higher, and of course it will be higher, but it still has to be within the range of reasonable. So I'll leave you with two questions. The client has to know, and the different states have different rules about when the client has to know and has to approve. I'll leave you with two questions. Number one, in one direction, is it ever true that the total fee is reasonable if realistically the client could have gotten a discount from the lawyer to whom it was being referred if he didn't have to send some money back to the referring lawyer? I don't know the answer to that question, but I was recently asked. And the other question, completely in the opposite direction, and this is a question for all of us in the bar, are these rules appropriate in the 21st century, or should we just throw it all open and have no restrictions whatsoever on referral fees to lawyers, to non-lawyers, et cetera?
Professor Vivian, any closing thoughts before we wrap up?
No closing thoughts, but closing thanks to all of you for spending some time with us this evening. Really appreciate it, and a lot of your feedback as well. Always a pleasure.
Terrific.
Great. Thank you.
Thank you again for joining us today. This concludes today's conference, and you may now disconnect. Have a great day.